All right, Buckeye fans, which camp do you sit in? Strong win against a quality opponent, or what was that? We need to be more dominant. What is it? We shall dive into it with Pat Murphy from Bucknuts 247 Sports, of course, with the Buckeyes coming off that 33-24 win at the Shoe against Penn State. Hey, Pat, how you doing today?
I'm good. How are you doing, Mark?
I am doing well. And of course, this Big East showdown round robin of sorts has cleared its first hurdle with Michigan State over Michigan and Ohio State besting Penn State. And as I mentioned off the top, it's a 9-point win. I still think, regardless of the 3-point or the 3 losses by Penn State, quality opponent, red zone issues in particular could have expanded this out to a more comfortable win. And that's probably the main issue on offense.
Certainly. And Ryan Day talked about it when we met with him on Tuesday, that if the Buckeyes score touchdowns in the red zone, which they've done rather effectively this year, I don't have the numbers in front of me, but they've been a good red zone team. And in the game, they still finished 5 of 6. They just kicked 4 field goals in the red zone, which is not what we've seen from Ohio State. In fact, the last couple of weeks when we've done our questions exchanged within the 247 Sports sites with the various teams, I've been asked about special teams, and I was like, well, there's not a ton to talk about. The Buckeyes, you know, they other than a few kickoff returns that have gone far, they haven't kicked a lot of field goals, and they don't punt a lot. And that was not the case against Penn State. They did both. So the issues to me are something that are fixable. I think, you know, something you certainly want to get worked out before you play Michigan State in the next couple of weeks. I imagine that Nebraska and Purdue, Ohio State's next two opponents, will look at what Penn State did in the red zone. I just don't know if either of those two teams have enough defensively to cause Ohio State the same kind of issues Penn State did. You know, not only was Penn State able to match up like for like talent-wise, they did some interesting schematic things. They shifted the defensive line, not just in the red zone. That was something that offensive line dealt with all game. And part of the reason that they were able to get some pressure and slow down the run game early in the game and things like that. So certainly something for Ohio State to look at. And I think you don't want to come out of a game being 1 of 6 in the red zone. But when you come out of that game being 1 of 6 in terms of touchdowns, in the red zone, and you still win by 9 points, you feel good about it. I think if you convert some of those, you're much closer to that 18-point spread, 19-point spread, whatever it ended up being. And we're talking about this game differently. So, you know, I think you can kind of see it either way. And you mentioned this game to be looked at as Ohio State beat a top 20 team at the time. The committee did not look at it that way. We'll get to that in a few minutes. But, you know, Ryan Day said coming in, this was a game that they just needed to win. He said after the game, it wasn't about style points when you play a team like Penn State, who's played the Buckeyes so tough these last several years. And Ohio State got out with a win. So I think all in all, you're looking to get better, looking to get back to what you were able to do these last few weeks, especially offensively, where they struggled a little bit more than I think everyone expected. But this wasn't going to be a, you know, blowout game like Indiana, Maryland, Rutgers, any of those. Penn State was going to come in, especially on the back of 2 straight losses, and play as well as they possibly could. And I think they did that. Ohio State still managed to win.
Folks, catch our picks on Patreon. 13-5 against the spread last week. 109-67 for the season. Again, that's against the spread. Money line much better than that, around 80%. You can catch our picks on Patreon, Mark Rogers TV. Just search it right there. We got Pat Murphy on the line for Bucknuts 247 Sports. Ohio State over Penn State to move on to 7-1 and undefeated in the Big Ten. And Nebraska's up ahead. I guess, Pat, on the defensive side, we've seen this progression from Ohio State week to week. Pretty dominant performances in Big Ten play against the 3 opponents most recently, and then waiting for that one more capable opponent. Was that Penn State? Well, from a rushing standpoint, they don't run against anyone, and they certainly couldn't run against the Buckeyes. So it all became Sean Clifford. It all rested on his shoulders. He had to throw it 52 times. And pretty capably. So there were, again, some shots taken in the secondary and pretty successfully.
You mentioned the 52 throws, 361 yards and a touchdown, also an interception from Sean Clifford. I think I look at it like this. This defense was not good at the beginning of the year. They were trying to figure a lot of things out. they are still working through that process of getting to where they want to be. And I think you saw that they've made progress against a much better offense than they faced these last several weeks. It was an okay to good performance. You'd like to see Sean Clifford's numbers come down a little bit, but like you said, he threw it so many times and they kind of abandoned the run throughout the game, especially later in the game, trying to come back from behind. That you know, the numbers were going to be there, I think. I still don't know if this is an elite level championship defense, but I also know in college football these days, with the way the rules are and how offenses have been, we've seen teams win a national championship with just a good enough defense. So, you know, it's kind of the opposite of what people are talking about with Georgia right now. There's questions about that offense to some degree, and that defense is absolutely dominant. I think Ohio State's offense, which continues to be ranked the best in the country, is good enough to get them where they need to be. And this defense just has to be good enough to not allow opponents to just run up the score or even make it a back and forth fight, get stops when they need to. And that's what they were able to do against Penn State. And they will face more difficult opponents, especially if they make the college football playoff offensively. But I think this defense just keeps getting better. They keep adding some new things, some different wrinkles, things like that. And every week, obviously, they are working on this different scheme that they've implemented. And so I like the progression. Obviously, you wish, as a Buckeye fan, you wish that it was going faster and this defense was, you know, just absolutely dominant and they were great on both sides of the ball. But when you start from the place where Ohio State started at the beginning of the season, and, you know, we can have a whole discussion about whether they should have been in that place, but they were. So when you start there at this point in the year, you're a little over halfway through. I think they're making good progressions. And I think you saw some of that on Saturday night, but it definitely needs to continue to get better. You need to see dominant performances these next 2 weeks and then be ready for those last two games against Michigan State and Michigan, both of which will challenge the Buckeyes in different ways.
And I don't know if we're seeing it necessarily on a consistent basis, but a more frequent basis, that the overwhelming talent on the defensive front, we see it flash more repeatedly now than we did weeks ago, where just all of a sudden it's like, yeah, these guys are really talented. And when they've got it together, they can like meet at the quarterback, as they did for that scoop and score play right there. Christmas is coming. Everybody's going to be on Amazon, or a lot of people. Shop Amazon. Use the link we've got in the description in the section below. Doesn't cost you a penny. Same shopping experience. Check out Pat Murphy's work, of course, on Bucknuts 247 Sports. Now we've got a date against Nebraska. Don't look at the overall record. It's not going to be impressive, or the Big Ten record. They've only won one game in the conference, and that was by 7 touchdowns over Northwestern. It was pointed out on our Buckeye Weekly live show that they're 16th in the nation in total offense. Well, they did play Fordham, and they racked up like almost 700 yards against Northwestern. That may have skewed that just a bit. It's a team that, in the win-loss column, is struggling, but nobody beats them by more than a score. They took Michigan State to overtime. They took Michigan to a 3-point game in which they had a late lead. So they have to be taken seriously, especially on the road.
You just touched on exactly what Ryan Day talked to us about on Tuesday. The fact that they haven't lost a game by more than 8 points, I think it is, this year. That Nebraska's just been tough to beat. Yeah, like you said, the record isn't great, but there has been signs of life, I guess, from Lincoln and things under Scott Frost. The biggest thing for me in this game is you can't have one of those trap games. And actually, it's funny because if you look back at some of Ohio State's, some of those bad losses, even some underperforming wins, it's come more often than not against a team after the week after the game after Penn State. So obviously the Buckeyes really get up for that game. And, you know, it's not the Michigan game, but there's no, that's kind of the number two rival for the Buckeyes. And it tends to have a bit of a letdown sometimes. So the coaching staff, the players have to avoid that this week. The preparation has to be high, because what's important for Ohio State right now in these next 2 weeks is just winning games comfortably, like you were the last few weeks, as you, you get to Michigan State and Michigan at the end of the season. Obviously on the road in Lincoln, a place where Ohio State's actually had a good amount of success, lost the first trip there when Nebraska was in the Big Ten, but has won pretty comfortably there the last few times. So you know, I expect Ohio State to be focused and ready. This team obviously already has one loss. They know they can't afford another one, or even just a bad performance at this point. You know, you need a good win, a comfortable win against an opponent like this. So I expect that from the Buckeyes. But, you know, I think that it's good to hear Ryan Day drive home that message of, look, they've played these teams tough. Turn on the tape. You can see what they did to Michigan. You can see what they did to Michigan State, two teams that are obviously very good. So I think that'll have the Buckeyes' attention in this one. And I think they're delivering the right message over there at the Woody Hayes Athletic Center.
Only lost to Oklahoma by one score on the road as well. We got Pat Murphy on the line, Bucknuts 247 Sports. We would ask that you would like the video, share these videos out on social media, subscribe right here at the Voice of College Football, and check out Pat's work, of course. All right. Yeah, these college football playoff rankings, everybody's probably seen them at this point. The initial rankings released on Tuesday night. The notables are Georgia, a firm number one, Alabama two, then Oregon back at four, the Buckeyes one spot back at five. So what do you take from what we can clue in on based on what the committee's thinking is?
Well, it looks to me, and I wrote about this earlier today, you know, Ohio State's in a pretty good spot. My colleague Dave Biddle and I, on our podcast earlier this week, we both projected that Ohio State would be down at seven. I thought Oklahoma and Cincinnati would be ahead of both of, or both would be ahead of Ohio State, given they're both undefeated. So what I got out of this is that head-to-head matters to this committee, at least right now. We'll see how it goes the rest of the season and who you've played. One of the reasons Ohio State is behind Oregon head-to-head. Gary Barta, the committee chair, said on the conference last night that was basically the reason. And then he also said that Ohio State does not have a signature win at this point. They did not view that Penn State win, Penn State not ranked, as a signature win. Minnesota, who is ranked, I think 22nd or something like that.
I think they're 20 even.
Okay, so somewhere in the 20s. You know, that's the best win in the committee's eyes for Ohio State, and obviously that was back in week one. So Ohio State has an opportunity here. They're going to play Michigan State. They're going to play Michigan. It's likely that those two teams will still be in the top 10, assuming they don't drop, you know, a game between now and then. So the opportunities are there. It's possible that both Oregon and Ohio State could make the playoffs. So I'm not sure that if you're an Ohio State fan, you really have to worry too much about what Oregon's doing. I do think it's interesting that Oklahoma's as far back as they are. I think they're at number eight. That one, if they win out, they play both Baylor and Oklahoma State, who are, I want to say, 10 and 11, something like that, 11 and 12. And so opportunities for Oklahoma, who until last week hasn't looked good, but has won all of its games. And, you know, being undefeated is something, especially in a Power Five conference. So if they win out, that could make things a little more interesting. Does Cincinnati have any opportunity to jump into that top four? Given their future schedule, it doesn't look like it, because the committee, you know, with them having already beaten Indiana and Notre Dame on the road, didn't seem to value much of that. The Notre Dame game carries some weight, obviously. So, and, you know, obviously the SEC championship game will be interesting, assuming Georgia and Alabama keep winning. You know, that'll set up a game where if Alabama wins, I think both teams probably get in. And if Georgia wins, then you would assume Alabama drops out, but we'll see. So, you know, I think that Ohio State will be fine. You just have to keep winning, keep doing what you're doing. It's just, you know, it's a matter of handling your business. But each week the committee evaluates things in its own way. So you never know what one rankings looks like compared to another. But I think Ohio State's in a good place. I think the wins will the strength of schedule, if they keep winning, will help. And, you know, if the Buckeyes win the Big Ten, it would be very difficult for me to see them getting left out. And we know that chaos is going to happen at some point. We've already seen it at some point this year. I don't imagine that we're just going to see chalk the rest of the season, right? So, you know, if Ohio State just handles what it has to do, well, it seems like a third straight playoff appearance for the Buckeyes.
Well, hopefully the committee doesn't believe that teams just drop off the table and off the face of the earth after 25, because Penn State can play with these teams in the lower portion of the top 25. Shoot, they beat number 13 in 21 and may have beaten 22 with a healthy Sean Clifford. So,
right.
That I certainly would take Penn State to win against the San Diego State and Fresno States of the world in the bottom of that top 25. All right, Pat Murphy, Bucknuts 247 Sports, breaking down the Buckeyes for us each and every week. Pat, we appreciate you stopping by as always.
Absolutely.